Now, another addition to the NewsHour bookshelf. Ferguson, Baltimore, Charleston, just three of the roll call of American cities where deadly violence has been directed against black citizens this year. It's an issue confronted head-on by Atlantic magazine columnist Ta-Nehisi Coates in his newest book, Between the World and Me. He talked recently with Hari Sreenivasan in our New York studios.
Toni Morrison, someone who knows a little something about literature,
just
says this is required reading. I want to start with one of the quotes in your book. In America, it is traditional to destroy the black body. It is heritage. What does that mean?
Well, it's a statement of history. I mean, the African-American presence in this country begins roughly, you know, about the time that, you know, this country's deep history begins, 1619. After that, we had 250 years of enslavement. After that, we had 100 years of Jim Crow. Jim Crow was enforced through violence, through destruction of black bodies, through lynching, through mass murder, through terrorism, up until this very day, you know, where we are in this era right now, where we have police forces, you know, who are in our, you know, communities, and we, you know, it seems like every week get a shooting or somebody beat to death or somebody, you know, as we have with Sandra Bland, somebody, you know, who dies under mysterious circumstances. And we accept this as a normal way of doing business. We think that it is okay to have the world's largest prison population. And we think it's okay that, you know, one particular ethnic group be overrepresented in that population. Prisons are violent. Incarceration is a violent experience. Bodies are destroyed in prison. There's just no way to get around it as far as I'm concerned.
So you write this as a letter to your 14-year-old son. It almost a guide to figure out a way to protect his body. You had a passage in there when he waited up for the kind of the decision on the Michael Brown case, and he went to his room and started crying. But what was interesting is your response wasn't to go in there and tell him that it was going to be okay. What'd you say?
I told him it won't be okay. I told him this is what it is. This is your country, you know, and you know, frankly, better get used to a lot more of this, and you have to figure out how you're going to live. You know, that's your charge.
You're already an Amazon bestseller. That's positive feedback. Were you expecting some of the negative pushback as well?
Not like I got, because I think as a writer, like, I'm in my own head. Like, I was thinking about, like, I just wanted it to work. So, no, I was not, you know, prepared. It just required me to shift away from the internal process of a writer and to sort of examine some things externally.
Someone we have on the program every week, David Brooks, was one of the first pieces of critique that came out. And he said you distort history, that it's unfair to look at America through just the lens of violence, that for every KKK there is a Harlem school zone, that the American dream is what binds people across race, across caste and class.
Well, I appreciate David actually reading the book. I appreciate him engaging in the book, engaging with the book and writing a column about that, and not just sort of ignoring it. But I obviously pretty strongly disagree with that. The Harlem Children's Zone is a relatively new invention. It's called the Harlem Children's Zone. It is not a Harlem Children's Zone in every community in America, in every black community in America. I understand this point, something like the Harlem Children's Zone. There isn't. The Harlem Children's Zone actually represents a fairly unique level of investment in the lives of young black people. But more than that, let's talk across time. The Ku Klux Klan is the most lethal domestic terrorist organization in American history. That's what they are. They have marked out history for the past 150 years. I believe the Harlem Children's Zone is probably about 10 or 15 years old. That sort of comparison I don't think works. I mean, his point about, you know, for every Jefferson Davis, there's an Abraham Lincoln. No, Abraham Lincoln is pretty singular. Abraham Lincoln was assassinated for making a stand effectively against white supremacy. There was not another president, you know, as progressive as him, you know, who made that sort of stand, probably for another 100 years, disregarding Ulysses S. Grant. I mean, with that exception. That's unique. That's very, very, very unique. Jefferson Davis is actually quite normal, regrettably, across American history. So I disagree with that.
At what point does personal responsibility play into this?
I am obviously for personal responsibility. I think there's plenty exhibited by black people across history. And right now, I think, you know, black people are fairly normal. I think we are about as responsible as everybody else. What sets black people apart is not, you know, some deficit in personal responsibility. It's the weight on our shoulders. That's what's actually different. We have the weight and burden of history. How long are we content to have, you know, a Sandra Bland in a situation in which her body is detained effectively for failing to, you know, signal for a turn, and ends up there. How long are we okay with that? How long are we okay with Freddie Gray, you know, basically dying for living in the wrong neighborhood? You know, I don't know. I'm not okay with it. I can't be okay with it.
So what is the possibility in the future? Let's say you get this, you
right.
read the book, you understand it, you become at some level more aware.
The possibility is really, really humility. I don't think America is an especially bad actor. You know, there's no other country I expect to go to and find that, you know, the people are somehow better. We don't have to be in a world where we, you know, look out, you know, on our cities, where we look out into West Baltimore and suddenly, you know, we see somebody burning down a CVS and we're shocked that that happened. And we act like that sort of, you know, sprang out of nowhere, where we see people on the streets of Ferguson who are totally upset. And it takes a Justice Department report 6 months later for us to realize that the municipal government of Ferguson was basically plundering those people.
Why do you think this is happening now? This conversation is gaining this kind of momentum today about race in America. Unfortunately, it's been on the backs of these tragedy after tragedy yeah. after tragedy, right?
Well, I think two things are happening. One is very similar to what happened during the Civil Rights Movement. There was a technological leap. And so the kind of violence that you saw on Bloody Sunday was not particularly remarkable in American history for black people. But suddenly there were news cameras there. It was the capacity to carry that out all across the world all of a sudden, and everybody could see it blatantly for what it was. You have a similar revolution with the presence of cameras everywhere. You know, people having, you know, the ability to actually see the police officer shoot Walter Scott in the back. I also think having an African-American president, just the mere fact of, you know, having, you know, the leader of the free world be black has thrown all of this stuff in relief. You know, the president has, you know, repeatedly time after time been called upon to respond to this stuff. And there's been some expectation that as an African-American, he will respond in a way that maybe, you know, someone else would not, that he would have more insight in a way that someone else would not. And so I think that's ramped up everything.
All right, Ta-Nehisi Coates, the book is called Between the World and Me. Thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you, all right. Thank you so much.